good place to be this morning, amen? Yeah. Well, at this time, Kristen has an announcement she's going to make, so she's going to come forward. It looks like she's going sailing. In a very small boat, yes.
Good morning. I'm here to share some happy news today. Are you ready for some happy news? Good. So as a procedural thing in the Nazarene denomination, when we've had a pastor in place for 2 years, the board meets together with the superintendent, district superintendent, and we do a review of our pastor. And so I'm just letting you know from the board that we did that in January. And we gave very, very high marks to our pastor. And the happy news is that we extended, extended his call for 4 more years. So I'm sure that we all feel the same way, but I feel like we're very, very blessed to have Pastor Darren and Don. And I feel like he has been brought to us just for such a time as this. For all that we've gone through, he's been a wonderful, solid leader to us. And so I appreciate that, Pastor. And one of the things also that went on with that review was a self-review of the board. And one of the items that we were to review for ourselves was how well do we support our pastor? One of the things was, do I pray for him every day? I've challenged myself. I pray for you, Pastor, but I don't know that I could say I prayed for you every single day. But now I've challenged myself to pray for him every single day when I have my prayer and devotions. And also when he comes to the platform. And I just think how powerful it would be if every Sunday, every time he comes to the platform, if every one of us would just lift him up and just ask for the Holy Spirit to speak through him clearly and boldly, and for our hearts and minds to be open to what he has to say to us. And so I have a little gift to present to you, Pastor, just in recognition.
I said in the first service, I'll just stay up. In the first service, that's good news for the staff too, when with a good review like that. That makes us breathe easier as well. Well, let's continue to worship this morning as we are here to give our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ praise.
There is a river of gladness pours from Emmanuel's veins. The sinner was plunged beneath the flood, and God saved. And since then I walk in forgiveness. All of my guilt was erased. The chains of the past broken at last, I got saved. Oh, I got saved. I'm undone by the mercy of Jesus. I'm undone by the goodness of the Lord. I'm restored and made right. He got a hold of my life. I've got Jesus. How good I want and tasted your grace, and I roll over my bones, and sorrow comes to steal the joy I own. And brokenness and pain is all I know. I won't be shaken, I won't be shaken. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. Shame no longer has a place to hide. I am not a captive to
Savior, Jesus Christ, we don't need to fear anything. It's not just because he takes care of us, it's because we can look back and know the things that he's done in ours and others' lives, and that he's there to take care of us. And I didn't finish talking before the intro was over, I'm sorry, but someday we're going to get to see him face to face. I get to see all of you there with me as we're praising him for those things that he's done, but ultimately for the sacrifice he made, willing to leave his glory to come here for me and for you so that we can be saved. And one day you'll make everything new, Jesus. One day you will bind every former things shall all pass away, no more tears. One day you'll make sense of it all, Jesus. One day every question resolved, and every
Here this morning. If you're watching online with us, our church family has suffered a great loss this last week. One of our dear brothers, 50 years old, was in a tragic accident and went to be with Jesus. And so we had the celebration of life service yesterday, and it was, I think, just that, celebration of life. And his dear family that is here, many are at the altar today. We just want to pray for this family. This family is dear to us, and we love them deeply. We also had someone that was deployed. Their unit was deployed, and so another one of our men. And one of my favorite pictures in my mind from recent days was gathering to pray for Daniel in his deployment last Sunday, and Henry being right there front and center, leading the charge. So maybe others would like to step out and surround these two families represented here. Maybe you have a need, too, that you'd like to bring to the altar. We're just going to take some time this morning, and it's us, it's the family, and so we're going to gather. I'm sure many of you watching online have deep needs, too, and we want you to know that we're with you and that we value you and that we want to pray for you as well. There's a tab that you can click and that you can share your prayer requests, and they will come directly to us in real time. Also, if you're watching on the church online platform, we have a team of people that will interact with you right now immediately if you have a specific need to pray for. When I think of the body of Christ, this is what I think of. Brothers and sisters that pray for each other, help each other. Let's go to the Lord together. The rest of you, please be seated. Father, we're broken today. In fact, we're not even sure how to process all of this, all of our feelings and emotions, other than we know we need to bring them to you. So God, here we are. We just offer ourselves to you today. And we want you to know that recognize we need you desperately. Lord, I thank you that you have provided everything for us, and that you have paved the way, and that you have experienced every human emotion when you traversed this earth. And as you gave your life, and as God raised you to life on the third day, it gave you power over sin, death, hell, and the grave. And you say you have given us the keys to the kingdom. And so we have that at our disposal. And so, Lord, we thank you, but it just feels so difficult right now, so painful. Lord, we thank you that we have the assurance of where Henry is today because of a decision that he made 5 years ago to accept you as his Savior. Oh God, what hope that gives us today. And so, as Pastor Dan says, we want to see Henry again. We want to be together again. And if we are in you, we have that assurance. And so, God, we just say yes to you in every area of our lives. Maybe there's someone here today who is hurting physically. God, I pray for a special touch. Lord, maybe there's someone that's hurting emotionally to the point of depression. God, I just pray that you would speak peace and help and healing. And Lord, we know there are many here that are just grieving. God, we pray for Katie. We pray for the boys. We pray for the extended family. Would you just hold them in your arms? God, would you be with Chrissy today and the girls and just hold them? And God, would you just take care of Daniel and bless him and his unit, we pray. For all of these things and the other needs among us, God, we're just giving them to you. And again, we're admitting that we can't do anything about these, but Lord, we're just offering them to you and asking that you speak peace, help, and blessing. And we're trusting what you have said to us and how that you are the God of all comfort. And in fact, Lord, we're just praying John 5:25 when you say, I tell you the truth, whoever hears my word, believes him who sent me, has eternal life and will not be condemned. He, she has crossed over from death to life. We thank you that we know where Henry is. He has made that crossing over. But we also thank you today, Lord, for the eternal life that each of us has in you, beginning here on earth. When we have that relationship with you. So God, would you just make that life abundant in us? Would you help us to recognize that? Would you just birth fresh new wind and spirit and fire and life into us by your precious Holy Spirit? So Lord, we're trusting you. Even when our heart doesn't feel it, we are holding your hand and we're saying, lead us, Lord, we will follow. Lord, I thank you for this great congregation. I thank you for the way that they have been a blessing to us. And I thank you for the way they have blessed this family even this week. And so, God, again, we're offering ourselves to you today. We're saying that we love you and we need you. And we pray all of this in the precious name of Jesus. And together, God's people said, amen. What a beautiful picture. What a great picture of the family of God. We're looking at Luke's gospel together today, chapter 12. We're going to be in verses 42 to 48, but we'll actually start a little bit prior to that. So you might just prepare your Bibles accordingly. Sometimes there are no words. You know, the scripture says that there are times the Holy Spirit will utter groans for us and pray for us when we don't have those words. And I think this situation is kind of one of those. So don't be afraid to talk to God and tell him, even when you don't have words to describe how you're feeling. And he can do that for us, in us, and through us. We're talking about stewardship today for a few moments. Last week we talked about giving of our time, and so today we're actually encompassing that plus everything that God has given us, including our resources. And so I think if there's a response to anything that we have seen over the last week, I think it is this. And honestly, I think if there's a message for us all today, it's this message of hope that God is calling us to a deeper, more fervent love for Him, and a deeper, more fervent love for others, and to serve others, maybe in ways we haven't before, or deeper than we have before. So I think this is a very timely message for where we are as a church family. So this is one of those really strange parables. In fact, it's one that, you know, you read, and some of it you just kind of scratch your head and go, what does that mean? I just want to remind you, when Jesus taught in parables, a lot of times he wasn't trying to have us look at every specific word and apply that directly to our lives. He was trying to help us to see a couple of big picture thoughts and just to pull those in. And that's really what we're doing here together today in this passage. So there's some really good stuff that we're going to look at. But again, there's some stuff that might be a little confusing, and we'll walk that together. We're in this together. Let me just give you some thoughts on some of the things that Jesus talked about in the scripture. There are 500 verses in the word on prayer, a few less than that on faith. There were 2,000 verses on monies and possessions in the scripture. Think of that. 10% of the verses in the Gospels deal with money and possessions. 16 of the 38 parables that Jesus taught deal with possessions and monies. And 15% of Jesus' overall teachings deal with monies and possessions. Isn't that interesting? That's greater than the number of times he taught on heaven and hell combined. So all of that tells me that this was really important to him. Well, he knew this was important to us. And so he wants to help us through this and have a kingdom mindset when it comes to our stewardship. So we're talking about this, the Believe series. If we have these beliefs and we hold these things to be true, then now our lives have to measure up to that, have to match what we say we believe. So the way that we live that out. And so what we're looking at today is, how can we be faithful stewards in this season? Now look with me at Luke chapter 12. In fact, we're going to look back at verse 15 to start with. Look at what Jesus said here. He said, "Watch out, be on your guard against all kinds of greed. A man's life does not consist in the abundance of his possessions." So we move on to verses 20 and 21. He's talking about greed there in 15. And in verses 20 and 21, he's telling this parable of the rich fool. And it's the man who was blessed really by God and didn't give God credit and said, "Well, hey, I've got all this stuff. What am I going to do with it?" And so he built bigger bins for his grains, and he just kept enjoying life and using it only for himself. And God said in verse 20, "You fool, this very night your life will be demanded from you. Then who will get what you've prepared for yourself? This is how it will be with anyone who stores up things for themselves but is not rich toward God." So in this same chapter, in the same discourse, this conversation that Jesus was having with his disciples and others, he's talking about greed and money. He's talking about giving. And look at verse 31. He's talking about worry in this passage. And he says, "But seek his kingdom, and all these things will be given to you as well." You don't have to worry about the details, the little things. If you just focus the big picture on me, I can help you and bless you. In verse 34, "For where your treasure is," think of this, "there your heart will be also." It was one of the beautiful things about the service yesterday. We knew where Henry's treasure was. It was in his family and others. It was in his God family and others, and that was evident. And so where is our treasure? And we have to trust God. And then look at verse 35. He goes into this section that we're going to deal with a little bit later, but he says, be dressed, ready for service, and keep your lamps burning. And so he's talking about preparedness and being ready. So pull all of that into this conversation of being a faithful steward. So this is where we're headed today, okay? So here we are in our text, verses 42 to 48. Are you ready? Let's look at this together. The Lord answered, who then is the faithful and wise manager whom the master puts in charge of his servants to give them their food allowance at the proper time? It will be good for that servant whom the master finds doing so when he returns. Truly, I tell you, he will put him in charge of all his possessions. But suppose the servant says to himself, hey, my master is taking a long time in coming, and he then begins to beat the other servants, both men and women, and to eat, drink, and get drunk. Can I just tell you something? Just pause here for a moment. Drunkenness is always a sin in the Scripture, okay? It's always a negative light. So we've got to be careful there. I'm thankful for the Church of the Nazarene stance against alcohol because it doesn't even get us to the precipice where we're even close to that. Something to just think about here as we go through this conversation. The master of that servant will come on a day when he does not expect him and at an hour he is not aware of. He will cut him to pieces and assign him a place with the unbelievers. The servant who knows the master's will and does not get ready or does not do what the master wants will be beaten with many blows. But the one who does not know and does things deserving punishment will be beaten with few blows. From everyone who has been given much, much will be demanded, and from the one who has been entrusted with much, much more will be asked. And we're reading some of that, and we're going, what does that even mean? Well, let's just kind of check this out for a little while. We'll just try to get into this. The first big picture thought, first of three, is God is seeking faithful and wise managers. He is seeking those. Verse 42, who then is the faithful and wise manager? Who can I trust? God is asking. He's asking this question. Who of you are willing to do what I'm asking and will help serve others with the blessings that I want to bestow upon you? See, the master puts us in charge. The master owns it all, and that's really stewardship 101 is God owns it all. You know that. We know that, don't we? He owns it all. Everything that we have is a good gift from God. We sang about it. The praise team led us beautifully this morning, and aren't you thankful for them? Can I tell you, they helped make yesterday a worship service rather than a funeral. It was a beautiful time. I think he was pleased. And so Jesus is asking, who is willing? Who can I trust? Who can I entrust these gifts to help others? I told you 2 weeks ago about a former district superintendent of mine that had such a big impact on my life and was challenging in so many ways to me, so many areas. He challenged me and just a very godly man and just a passion to see people saved and to plant churches. And he and his wife made a decision several years ago that whatever God blessed them with, 25% of that immediately was going out the door back to God and his kingdom. And he said, God has blessed us abundantly. We're just giving to his kingdom and God is taking care of us. So in that culture, a steward had some power, really, really did, because he had some authority because it came from the master. Master gave the steward the authority, and then the servants underneath them, he had the ability to share with them and to bless them and to help them. And so the master was really entrusting this person to carry out the plan of the family, the plan of the master. And there's really a beautiful picture of what God is asking from us. Not that we're in a hierarchy over others, no, but when God blesses us, it's in turn to share with others. See, he gives us these things. He gives us the resources, the monies, the ability. He gives us all of these to share with others. Now, just think about this for a moment. Regardless of how much we have in the bank or even how many talents we each consider we have, each of us is a leader. Do you know what leadership is? Leadership is influence. Now, some of us have more people that we influence than others. I get that. But each of us has a sphere of people around us that we influence on a daily basis. or at least a regular basis. So what is that? How are you using the influence? Think of this. How are you using that influence that God has given you for the sake of the kingdom to give back to God? I was reminded in the Daniel fast last month that I really can do without some things. Okay, not long. But, you know, we did without meat and we did without dairy products for 10 days. Some of us were just moaning and groaning. But we saw that we can do without some of that. So what if God is saying, hey, I know this is a sacrifice for you. I know, but what could you give to me in this season to help bless others and to further the gospel, to further the kingdom of God? When I look at Joseph's life, and recently I've been reading in Genesis about Joseph's life. In chapter 41, he's to the point where he is a manager over Pharaoh's stuff, over everything. I mean, when you think about that story, it's just a remarkable God story. I mean, he brings him out of literally the dungeon, and he places him now to probably the second highest ruler in the world, really, at that time, because the whole region was in a famine, and everyone was coming to Egypt to get their resources, their food. And it says, when the famine had spread over the whole country, Joseph opened all the storehouses and sold grain to the Egyptians, for the famine was severe throughout Egypt. Now, can I tell you something? That didn't just happen overnight, and God didn't just say, okay, I've got the bins full, you just need to go and open the door, Joseph. No, this was just a process in Joseph's life as he started as a young man serving God, and he was faithful to God here, he was faithful to God in the next step, he was faithful in this stage, in the dungeon he was faithful, and when the cupbearer and the baker came to him and said, hey, we've had these weird dreams, can you talk to us about these dreams? And he says, well, I can, and one of you is going to be really happy, and the other is not going to like this very much. He was faithful to share the truth and the word of God. And so at this point in his life, he had been faithful when God helped him understand Pharaoh's dreams and what was about to happen with the 7 years of plenty. And then Joseph put that into practice, and he was faithful. And you see what happens when we're faithful to God. And God is asking, who's the next Joseph? Who can I entrust to be faithful and help my people? What if the blessings that God will give you in the next 30 days are earmarked for someone else, and you're just a conduit? you're just a vehicle. To who God wants to bless. Look at the end of this verse 42, just quickly before we move on. It says, in charge of his servants to give them their food allowance. You like that phrase, their food allowance? Reminds me of in college when we traveled for the school, we would get a food allowance. And we wouldn't have to eat at the college cafeteria there when we were traveling. Who will give the food allowance? Who is it that God wants to bless that maybe even just what you would give or what you would help them would enable them to even eat for the next day? And this phrase, at the proper time. So when is the proper time? Well, the proper time is when there's a need, amen? So what I think the Holy Spirit is saying to all of us today, who's willing to be a faithful servant, a faithful steward, faithful manager? When you see a need, it's time to take care of the need. Second big picture thought we see in verses 43 and 44, that God rewards faithfulness and fruitfulness. Now, we had a garden this summer, and it was amazing. You know, in southeast Kansas, we had to do a lot of work, and it's hard to get stuff to grow in a rock. It's just really tough, I've noticed. But here in Iowa, you just throw something in the ground. Here's a seed, just, you know, chuck it over there, and it's growing, and it's amazing. The soil that is here, you all know this. What a blessing. But, you know, once in a while, we had that corn stalk, and it would grow tall, and it would look good, and then you'd go to, you know, when you're going to pick that big old ear of sweet corn, and it's the wrong time of year to be talking about this, isn't it? We can't even eat it after church. But, you know, those big, luscious, plump ears of corn. Well, we had a few that, I don't know what happened, but they were tired. And they didn't produce anything. They produced an ear, but it had nothing on it. It was like a white stalk. I'm not sure what I did. I'm sure it was something I did or didn't do. But you know, we've all had those. And so I think it's possible for us to be faithful in the wrong way. But God is calling us to be faithful and fruitful, to bear much fruit. Look at these verses. It will be good for that servant whom the master finds doing so. Doing what? Doing what the master wants. Doing what the master says. Doing the master's will. It will be good for that servant who obeys his master and fulfills that calling when the master returns. I tell you the truth, he will put him in charge of all his possessions. You see, God rewards that. He rewards faithfulness and fruitfulness. So if we're doing what God wants us to do, we're going to be fruitful. Do you know that? Maybe not how we measure. Maybe not be the number of people in a building. But if we're doing what God is calling us to do, we're going to be faithful and fruitful. All right, Lord, you take over. It's what you want. John 15, 16, Jesus said this, "You didn't choose me, but I chose you." I want you just to think about that for a moment. Each of us here, if we're in relationship with Christ, we have been chosen by him to go and to bear fruit and to bless his kingdom. Do you know that he has a plan for you, a ministry action plan for every one of us in Christ? He has that plan. If we're willing just to go and to obey him and to be faithful, he's going to bring about some amazing work through us. And there's a sowing principle. It's really a life principle in 2 Corinthians chapter 9. It says this, "Remember this, whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. Whoever sows generously will reap generously." It's a life principle. So it's just going to happen if we engage in that. So are you one who is sowing sparingly? Or are you one who is sowing generously? And I think we see that. What makes that evident, church, is the fruitfulness of our lives in ministry. So how are you sowing? Okay, here's another thought for us. In line with this, God's reward. And that is, he has shared with us that we are now what we call the priesthood of believers. So when Jesus died, that veil in the temple that was so thick, I'm trying to think how thick it was. Anybody remember how thick that veil was? 8 inches. Bob, would you say that? It was not one that you're just going to run up and grab and tear in two. And so in the temple, this veil was rent from top to bottom. God did it, of course, at the point of Jesus' death. And the symbolism there is so rich for us that now there is now no barrier between us and God. Think of this. Because of Jesus' sacrifice, that God raised him to life on the third day, there's no barrier now. So each of us, what this phrase, the priesthood of believers, the priest used to be the point of reference between the people and God. He was like the conduit between the people and God. And now what has happened, and 2 Peter will show us this, or 1 Peter 2, you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's special possession, that you may declare the praises of him who called you. So this concept of the priesthood of believers, we have direct access to God. Think of it. And so I think some of us need to get on our knees and utilize that access so we can hear what God is saying to us, and we can hear, "Lord, what do you need from me? What are my marching orders? Because I want to be faithful and I want to be fruitful." And that's the picture. He's been taking this a step further with me. I've got some tension in my life right now. Do you ever live in that tension with, "Oh, Lord, what are you saying? Help me to understand it. My thick, bald head, get that through for me. What is it you're telling me?" And he's been trying to help me see, and we've been talking a little bit about this on Wednesday nights in our refuge time. I thoroughly enjoy that prayer time. We also have a prayer time Sunday morning at 8:15. I would invite you to come to both of those and join us. I feel confident stepping to this podium on Sunday mornings because of that prayer time in there, and feel like God blesses that and gives me the okay to stand up here and share with you. But this is the passage that I'm just kind of in tension over. Matthew 16:19. I will give you the keys of the kingdom. These are the words of Jesus. Think of this, church. This is the priesthood of the believers. Every one of us, all of us, in Christ, have been given the keys to the kingdom. Whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. There's something to our prayers, the power of our prayers in the name of Jesus, when we're joining together, two or three, the scripture says, and God in our midst, and we're really seeking him, and we're asking him to do some things that only he can do. God, would you bind the spirit of depression? Would you bind the spirit of addiction? God, would you loose your Holy Spirit and your grace and mercy in the lives of these people? And some of us, faithful stewards, need to be about this and believe this with more than just head knowledge. May it drive us to our knees. May it drive us to our wallets. May it drive us across the street as we share the love of Jesus with our neighbor. Are you with me? Here's a thought. We mentioned that Henry served the Lord for 5 years as a follower of Christ. Good man before that. But for the last 5 years, Henry has been involved, and from what I've seen in my 2 years here, all in. And he's going to leave a void in many, many ways. And I think God is speaking to some of us to step up in that role. But here's a thought I had. I think Henry's done more in 5 years than some of us, maybe myself included, have done in how many years? We've seen faithful stewardship lived in front of us. Verses 45 through 47 talk about the final big picture thought, and that is God is calling us to account. But suppose a servant says to himself, my master's taking a long time in coming. Maybe you're there. Maybe you felt that way. I mean, the disciples, the apostles, thought that Jesus would come in their lifetime. You know, after the resurrection, when Jesus ascended there on the Mount of Olives back to heaven, they're thinking, well, maybe it's 2 weeks. Maybe he'll be back. And so the church has been looking for him for generations and years, and yet he tarries. And the scripture tells us because he longs for everyone to come to a saving knowledge of him. And so he's giving us more time. And so maybe you have been tempted like this servant to say, well, he's taking a long time. And so then look what happens. He begins to beat the men servants and maid servants. Now, this is where it gets really weird for us. And we're like, what does that mean? And kind of sounds like a phrase I heard when I was a kid. And the older guys would come to you and you were doing something they didn't like. They would tell you they're going to beat the tar out of you. Did you ever hear that? Maybe you were the recipient of one of those beatings. Well, I think what Jesus is really trying to say to us here is that he began to possibly mistreat people, but definitely neglect people. And I think when we look at it in that broader scope, it's easy to see, well, maybe that's me. Maybe I've neglected others that God has given me the ability to bless and to encourage and to help just because maybe I've been so busy to overlook. I just haven't noticed. In the story of the rich man and Lazarus, it's an interesting story. It's in Luke 16. Can you pull that up for us, verses 27 and 28? Thank you. So, some call this a parable, and I'm not sure, to be honest, because In none of the parables that Jesus tells, does he ever list a name. He doesn't name the people that he uses in the parable, except for the rich man and Lazarus. So is that really a parable? I don't know. Either way, there's a lesson that Jesus wants us to hear in that story, and that is this. The rich man who was now in Hades is having this conversation with Father Abraham. Are you singing the song, Father Abraham, in your head now that you hear that phrase? Had many sons. Pastor Dan will sing it for us. And so he's having this conversation with him, and he's longing for him to share with his brothers who were still on earth. He doesn't want them to come to this place of torment, basically. And you can see the scripture, and he says, no, it doesn't work that way. But here's what took place prior to that is Lazarus was a beggar at his gate. It says at his gate, at the rich man's gate. This man sat there, and he was in front of him. He had to go out the front gate every morning, and he passed that way, and he got to where he didn't even see him. It didn't even matter. Who is this? I don't know who this is. Is there even someone there? And I have to wonder if that's where we are, church. We've gotten so used to our routine and going out the front gate every morning, and there are people literally there who need our help, and we don't even see them because we're concerned about other things. And if we really want to live out our faith as faithful stewards, we've got to begin to see people as God sees them. Amen? Verse 46, the master of that servant will come on a day when he does not expect him. At an hour that he is not thinking about others, when he's just eating and drinking and being merry, enjoying the blessings that God has given him all to himself. And of course, I'm paraphrasing here. And passing by the very people that God is wanting us to help with blind eyes. He will cut him to pieces, assign him a place with the unbelievers. That servant who knows his master's will and does not get ready or does not do what his master wants will be beaten with many blows. What is that about? But the one who does not know and does things deserving punishment will be beaten with fewer blows. What Jesus is saying is there are consequences to our actions, and we are held accountable for what we know and either do or do not do. And so here's what happens. In our minds, we begin to do some things. So these beliefs happen in our minds. So we begin to form thoughts and opinions and belief by the Word of God when we read it, and then how we move that around in our mind. And you know that even in evangelicalism today, some don't believe that there is a hell. There's only a heaven. How do we get there? Jesus talked more about hell than he did heaven. But somehow we've transferred these things in our minds to now, oh, well, it's everybody goes to heaven. No, those who have a personal relationship with Jesus, when they die, go to heaven. And we think things like this in our mind. Well, God will overlook sin. Oh, I've got some sin in my life, but everybody does. At least I'm not as bad as that guy. And we begin to think these things, and we begin to compare ourselves with others. And God says, there's one standard, and it's what I think. It's my word. We can't live like the devil and claim to be like Jesus. And then here's what's going on. Look at what's taking place here in this verse, because I think it's really scary, and maybe one of the scariest things in here. The master of that servant will come on a day when he does not expect him. He thinks he's got all the time in the world. Look how long it's been. Jesus said he's coming back. William Barclay has a quote. Listen to this. This is rich. One of the most dangerous days of our life is when we discover the word tomorrow. One of the most dangerous days of our life is when we discover the word tomorrow, because we think we can put that off until then. I'll help that guy or that gal. We'll do it tomorrow. I'll tell them about Jesus tomorrow. And as we have seen tragically this week, we need to utilize the time that God has given us. So let's land this plane, shall we? A couple of quick stories. When we were in Bartlesville, we were there for 12 years on staff. The Lord started stirring some things in my heart and speaking to me about moving roles from the staff ministry I was in to this position. There were a couple of things that happened. There was a lady who offered a trip to Israel for the pastor and myself, and it was just an incredible blessing. So most of it was paid for. So I went on that trip, and God opened my eyes to many things. Then the church came alongside at some point and said, we want to help you and move you toward a master's degree. The pastor and I had talked about some things, and so they came alongside that and assisted in that endeavor. And those two things really, God began to shape and help and prepare and move me in another direction. And I've thought many times, what would have happened, where would I be if those wouldn't have happened? But I can say this. I'm convinced that I'm here today because of some of the influence of those two situations. And I wonder, the next pastor of this church, maybe someone, and I'm not planning to go anywhere tomorrow, okay? And I rejoice and we're so grateful in the extended call. We believe this has just been a blessing for us to be here with you. We love you all. But one of these days, I won't be here. And God has a plan for someone else. What if that person, the next person, is someone that he is asking some of you to invest in and to help them and to move them in their education and in their experience and in their discipleship? And we never know, do we? And that requires sacrifice. And so here's the last story, and then we'll pray together. So, the Battle of Yorktown. You remember this in your history? General Cornwallis, the commander of the British, had taken over Thomas Nelson's home. Thomas Nelson was one of the 56 signers to the Declaration of Independence, and one that the British had considered one who had committed treason against the kingdom because of signing that declaration. Thomas Nelson was one who had been very helpful with George Washington and the army, even supplying supplies, helping with funding some of their ammunition and their campaigns. And General Cornwallis had taken over his house and was using it as headquarters for the British Army. Now think of this. And so General Washington was friends with Thomas Nelson, and he was not going to bomb his home. And Thomas Nelson came to a point and he said, "You have got to bomb my home. They're setting up camp there. That's the hub. That we've got to eliminate that, even if it's my home." And we talked in first service that his insurance probably wouldn't cover this. So George Washington did just that, and he bombed that home, destroyed that home. And it was part of a key to that campaign, and, well, the rest is history. We should never have won that war. So what sacrifices? What homes? What walls, what barriers need to be destroyed today in order for us to be the faithful stewards that God is calling us to be? If you would like to join me at the altar, we're not worried about the past. We're just, from this point on, I'm coming today, and I'm going to kneel right here, and I'm going to say, "Lord, whatever, however, whenever, whatever, I'm yours, and all I have is yours." If you want to join me, there's room at the altar, there's room on the steps. You may want to come and stand. But could we just say, as God's people, We're all in. We want to be faithful. And we want to bear fruit for the kingdom. Would you join me? Father, I thank you for your presence here. I thank you that your Spirit is speaking, spoken to me this week. And Lord, we have run the gamut of emotions this week. And again, we just come to you needy today. But Lord, we also recognize the blessings that you have given us. And we cannot be selfish. We cannot be complacent. We cannot overlook the needs of others any longer. So God, would you open our hearts and our minds and our eyes to the Lazaruses that are literally at our gate every day. The friends at school, the colleagues at work, the people that we come across in the marketplace. Lord, would you help us to see them with spirit eyes like you see them? God, would you forgive us for overlooking them in the past? And Lord, would you just give us the ability to recognize who they are and what they need? And so, Lord, we're committing today, individually, as families, and as a church family, we say yes. And I think I can speak for all of us today that we want you to have first place, and we want you to use us as faithful stewards to bless a community and beyond. So, Lord, the conversations that we need to have, the conversations about your grace and your work in our lives, the testimonies that we need to share and give, we say yes, we're ready. When you open a door, we're going to walk through it by faith with you. Lord, you give us the words, and we'll just share. And would you just bring about a great harvest because of our commitment fresh and new to you. We love you. We thank you. We trust you. Lord, I pray for our church board meeting this week on Tuesday night. I pray that you would give us fresh vision and that you would give us wisdom as a group of leaders on where and when to go next for sharing you with this community and beyond. Thank you for the mission that you've invited us in. The assignments you've given us, God, may we be faithful. And we're trusting you to help us through it all. In the name of Jesus, we pray. And God's people said, amen. Amen. Thank you. God bless you.